just a real brief announcement. Next week, after this Mass, after the 8 o'clock Mass next Sunday, we're finished with the new nurses' station and the new boys' bathroom over in the school area, over in the old section of the school. And so we want to just bring a little blessing to that space, the nurses' station, and even the boys' bathroom. So we want to ask the Lord to kind of be present in those areas and to see about how God's love is everywhere, in all places, at all times. And so if you're wanting to be a part of that, right after our closing hymn next week, as we leave, we're going to just process right over to that area, just right over here on the other side of the bell tower, on the other side of the street over there where we go into the school, and we'll have the blessing at that time. And our home and school association with school is going to have some refreshments available after that blessing as well. And you'd be able to go and to take a new tour of the nurse's station and the boys' bathroom, and to see about how God has blessed us during this time of construction over there in getting that space ready. So that's going to be next Sunday, right after this Mass. In between the Masses, we'll have that opportunity for that little celebration. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Vincent de Paul Parish. Let's join together in praying for good vocations from our parish. The prayer is in the Gather Hymnal on the front inside cover at the top. Together we pray. Lord, you told us that the harvest indeed is great, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore, the Lord of harvest, to send laborers into his fields. We ask you to strengthen us as we follow the vocation to which you have called us. We pray particularly for those called to serve as priests, deacons, and religious sisters or brothers. May we be open and responsive to the call of serving your holy people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Welcome to this celebration of the Eucharist on the 28th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Because we are beginning prayer, please silence your phone now or turn it off. Now, in the spirit of Christian welcome, let's stand and take a moment to say hello to those near you. Our celebrant today is Father John. As we begin this celebration, let's pray together by singing number 837, Gather Your People.
Gather your people, O Lord, on earth, one. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. And having prepared ourselves to offer him these sacred mysteries, let us acknowledge to each other that we all arrive at salvation by the forgiveness of sins. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. I prayed, and prudence was given me. I pleaded, and the spirit of wisdom came to me. I preferred her to scepter and throne, and deemed riches nothing in comparison with her. Nor did I liken any priceless gem to her, because all gold in view of her is a little sand, and before her silver is to be accounted mire. Beyond health and comeliness, I loved her, and I chose to have her rather than the light, because the splendor of her never yields to sleep. Yet all good things together came to me in her company, and countless riches at her hand. The word of the Lord.
Teach us to number our days, that we may gain wisdom of heart. Turn back, O Lord, how long? Show pity to your servants. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. At dawn, fill us with your merciful love. We shall exult and rejoice all our days. Give us joy for the days of our affliction, for the years when we looked upon evil. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Let your deed be seen by your servants, and your glorious power by their children. Let the favor of the Lord your God be upon us. Give success to the work of our hands. Oh, give success to the work of our hands. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy.
A reading from the letter of the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, indeed the word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating even between soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and able to discern reflections and thoughts of the heart. No creature is concealed from him, but everything is naked and exposed to his eyes, to whom we must render an account. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt down before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus answered him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments: you shall not kill, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." He replied and said to him, "Teacher, all of these I have observed from my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You are lacking in one thing. Go, sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At that statement, his face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words, so again Jesus said to them in reply, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for one who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were exceedingly astonished and said to themselves, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For human beings it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God." Peter began to say to him, "We have given up everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Amen, I say to you, there is no one who has given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100 times more now in this present age, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions and the eternal life in the age to come." The Gospel of the Lord.
So I'm only one person, so I don't have a large set. They call the pollsters call this a sample field, I think. So I don't have a large sample field, but I've only heard one man ever admit that he was rich. Most people don't think in those terms. I mean, they don't want to admit it, especially after hearing a gospel like this. Of course, most people don't listen to this gospel, so there's that. But there's still a reluctance on people's part to actually admit to having wealth, right, and lots of it, right? So. I was in college up in Dubuque, Iowa. This is really a long time ago. And a young man comes bounding down the hall carrying a TV set that none of us today would even dream of having in our homes because it's so, you know, and it wasn't much of a TV even back then. And he said, "And we are an affluent society. I can get a TV in my college dorm room," you know. Well, I said, "Well, standards have changed." All right, so, you know, so that was back in 1970 or, yeah, 1970. See, I am that old. All right, so I'll go way back. Lots of things to remember. But anyway, so I was wondering about, you know, Jesus says things in today's gospel, but quite a bit, that people simply find unthinkable. Right. Well, why do they find it unthinkable? Well, I'm not going to give away. Who's going to give away all of their possessions? So, in order to follow Jesus, so well, nope, Peter. So, but actually, more people than you think actually do that. Right. So, but the payoff is really good. So, as Jesus notes. But most people find it unthinkable because they know they're not going to do it. And if you know you're not going to do something, why think about it? Right? So there's that. But he must have known that people would find the wealthy man would have found what he was saying. Just that would never have occurred to him before. But it makes that kind of speech, if you're capable of it, and Jesus certainly was, and after him many thousands, millions probably, all Christians, by the way, have been capable of that kind of speech. And it's effective and it's sharp, as the second reading says. It's effective and it's sharp, and it penetrates people to the marrow of their bones and gets between their soul and their thoughts. And it, either they're very attracted to it or they walk away immediately. Right? They don't say, do they still play Monopoly? Do they? Okay. You don't pass go and you don't collect $200. You just get the heck out of that person's company, right? So, and the rich man, you know, maybe he was looking for assurance. We don't know that eternal life is indeed possible, right? I mean, that is, you're getting down to the core of human desire there, right? I mean, the core, you know. Is this all there is? Is there something else? I mean, so there's that. I mean, he's looking for assurance. And it looks like Jesus leads him on a little bit, right? He says, the man does have the assurance that he has kept the commandments. And then comes the shocker, right? By keeping the commandments, you do not gain eternal life. Now that shocks any person in our tradition, right? Judeo-Christian tradition. It goes you're going way back, certainly beyond Jesus. So the people, as soon as they got the commandments, the purpose was to observe them, right? And by observing them, to be pleasing to God, and by being pleasing to God, to gain eternal life, right? So he says, well, that's, you have to sell everything instead and follow me. What? So anyway, so there you go. We want eternal life as he did, and we know that eternal life is possible. Everybody has always known that. They haven't been able to conceptualize it very well all the time, but they know it. But we want it on our terms. So the man goes away sad and crestfallen because he doesn't get it on his terms. All right, so, but he is also loved by Jesus. So there's different kinds of sadness. The most common one that we think about being sad is associated with loss. The people down in Florida and the southern states are experiencing sadness because of loss of homes, loved ones. You know, there have been deaths down there. That's a certain, the other kind of sadness is called regret, right? Which is a deep sadness. I could have done otherwise, but I didn't, and now it's too late, right? So the man could have done what Jesus told him to do. And he had to go through the rest of his life knowing that he didn't do it. Of course, he said, well, you can always change your mind, you know? Well, there is that, you know, so you can. So, and the other odd thing there is that Jesus, this is really what makes him really different. He does not want the man's wealth for himself. Right? Usually when people start asking you for money, it's usually going to go into their pocket or for the purpose of their project that they want to see accomplished, right? And Jesus doesn't do that. So this isn't going to be for me, for my disciples, or for any project that I wish to see accomplished in this life. It's going to the poor, which anybody would say, well, you're simply throwing your money away at that point. And I said, well, that might be your point of view, but I don't think it's God's point of view. So there's that. No, he's not going to keep it for himself. I said, well, how does he expect to accomplish? He did come to earth as God in order to accomplish something, and he did in fact accomplish it. There's two parts to it. Everybody gets part one right, Very few get part two right, and less as our what's left of our civilization marches on. So the, one of the byproducts of this activity by Jesus, you don't keep the wealth for yourself and you leave everything in order to follow him. What was the byproduct, the principal byproduct of that? And he would say, we call it Western civilization. Okay, so I said, if I say the word Western, which was enormously wealthy, it made possible young men in 1970 carrying TVs down the hallways in college dormitories, you know. And so that was 1970. Today it makes possible, if you don't have an iPhone, my goodness, are you even part of society? So there's that. So the wealth has been unprecedented. But if I say Western civilization, I wonder what that means to people anymore. I took a course, several of them. It was called Western civilization. I don't think they teach it anymore. So maybe they do. I don't know. But I'd be surprised if they did. So with the part one that Jesus gets of his project that was in fact accomplished was his death and his resurrection for the forgiveness of sins so that all people could be saved. Now, everybody knows that and they believe that. Well, not everybody. Anybody who goes to church, even those who don't go to church, still hang their hat on that. You know, and they always leave, most people leave out part two. You know, I'm old school. I say, if you get half of the answer right, you're wrong. Okay, because you only got it half right. You know, that's not quite good enough. So part two is that what he did accomplish was he built and is building his church, which is as important as part one. They kind of go together. So and a lot of people that simply are not, it's unthinkable. What's so important about the church? I say, well, we need to have a talk. It's kind of one of those situations. It's probably going to be a long talk, you know, because, so he came to build this church. You are Peter, and upon this, you know, Peter is the one who, not tell about Peter's emotions at the moment, whether he was astounded or it was a recent discovery. In other words, Peter had not fully realized yet that he had left everything in order to follow Jesus, which is possible. You just find yourself doing something and you don't remember when you began exactly doing it, all right? How did this happen, you know? Lord, we left everything. You know, so like I said, beginning with Peter, that is what seems to be the manner in which Jesus builds his church. His statement to the wealthy man. That's it. How is the church to be built? The church is to be built by people leaving behind everything in order to follow him. That's the church, right? And they say, we call that something in the centuries since. We call that having a conversion. It is a complete change of mind. Your mind completely flips, right? And without conversion, well, there will always be conversions because that's how Jesus builds his church, right? That's why he doesn't need money. He needs people willing to have a complete change of mind and, in fact, having one, right? So, Peter is the rock upon which he will build his church. Two things. He's doing the building. We aren't. Two, it's his church. It isn't ours. Right? So there's that. So why is there a church? Last night I was in Chaffee. I said, why is there a church in Chaffee? This morning I'm in Cape Girardeau. Why is there St. Vincent de Paul Catholic Church in Cape Girardeau, Missouri? who's even heard of Cape Girardeau? You know, there's probably more people who have not heard of Cape Girardeau than have heard of Cape Girardeau in the world. So we're not the most significant place upon the map. We're significant to us, certainly. And what's more important than that? But why is there a church here? Well, it's not because of our geographical importance, certainly, or our fame in the among the peoples of the world. There is a church here because Jesus built it here. And so, if he hadn't have done it, trust me, it wouldn't be here. And if he doesn't have people who will be his co-workers, it won't be here. Right? It's here, it's not physically necessary, or existentially necessary, as the fancy people would say. So the church, it's his church, and is his church is when someone, and probably the more the better, actually, give up everything for his sake and for the sake of the gospel. So that for as many people as possible, right, can believe that she is for those for whom the impossible must be done. That is why she exists.
We together profess the faith of Holy Church. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. All things are possible for God and his love for us. So we offer him now our prayers of petition.
For those who have chosen to leave all and follow Jesus more closely in the ordained or consecrated life, may they respond with the wisdom and understanding given by the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all legislators and judges, may they support laws and decisions that safeguard the dignity of human life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the citizens of Missouri, may we be thankful for the gift of life and have courage to advocate for the protection of the preborn and the preservation of parental rights. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For each of us, may we respond to the call of the Lord Jesus to be good stewards by giving generously of our time, talent, and treasure. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For For Deacons Tony, Mark, Tom, and Rob, as we celebrate Deacon Sunday, give them the eyes to see the needs of your people, a discerning mind to know your truth, and send your Spirit upon them as they serve the church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Jennifer Moore and Anthony Bruce, married this weekend, and for all married couples, may they be a true sign of God's love in the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead and those who will die this day, may Christ's mercy lead them into paradise. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Today we pray for the living and deceased members of the Marvin and Ruth Erhan family, for whom this Mass is offered, and for the prayers we hold in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And this is the campaign prayer. Almighty God, you have blessed us abundantly as a community. You continue to provide for our needs, and we entrust our future to you. We remember and are grateful for the sacrifices and hard work of previous generations from our parish. Inspired by the teachings of St. Vincent de Paul, help us now come together to continue our mission of fellowship, education, and spiritual growth while building on the cornerstone of Christ. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
St. Vincent de Paul,
pray for us.
St. Joseph,
pray for us.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness, we may pass over to the glory of heaven, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his Paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, by summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice, Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Vincent de Paul, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession and your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
the act of spiritual communion, my Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
And there's a young woman here named Abby. She's from the Newman Center. She wants to say a few words to us.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Father John, for letting me talk this morning. So my name is Abby Rollet. I went to SEMO from 2019 to 2022. I was a transfer in, and I'm here to talk to you guys a little bit about what the Newman Center has done for my life. I came to SEMO as a transfer to play softball, and before the Newman Center, my identity was completely an athlete. That's all I identified myself as. And whenever I got here, I put way too much emphasis on what the coach thought. And I had originally been only praying on the softball field. So then the coach took over my relationship with Jesus. I got lost in that. And then I had a teammate tell me that Catholics weren't Christian. And then I got injured. And then 2020 happened. So then I used COVID as an excuse to not go around the Newman Center, even though I had been searching for the truth there. And I had that time to heal, and I tried to go back into softball, but yet that still did not work out well for me. What amazed me was a year later, those same people welcomed me in with open arms, and some of those became my absolute best friends now. They taught me how to love with the love of Jesus. They taught me, they also taught me how to pray and to have a relationship with Jesus. And then within that, I was able to use the tools of attending Bible study and how to love and apply it after graduation. I went back home to Perryville and I started a young adult ministry for a little bit of time, for about a year with the help of friends. And I had a Bible study going with some really amazing girls. And then I also was a part of an evangelization team in St. Jen until my now fiance, Evan Dowdy, asked me on a date a little over a year ago. And I've been transitioning to life down here ever since. And I'm probably your newest member, parish member here. So I'm really excited to fight for souls with you all. Within all of that, I'm currently still getting to be active in the Newman Center. I get to live with Focus Missionaries there right now until Evan and I get married in May, which is a really cool opportunity, and I wouldn't have it without the Newman Center. And then also I get to be an example of a practicing lay person after college and what it's like to live after college in the faith. So all of that being said, spiritual warfare on the campus is really intense. There are people who truly don't believe Catholics are Christian, and there are also people who are completely lost and searching for their identity. And we all know our identity is our beloved children of the Father. I did not understand that until the Newman Center. And I want to search for more souls there on campus who are being won over by the devil. I want to fight for Jesus in that way. So I will ask for your prayers in that. And then within that, if you're looking for a place for all of your wealth to go, the Newman Center is a great place. Fighting for the souls for Jesus, and it's awesome. So thank you again, Father, and I look forward to serving with all of you. Thank you.
Let us pray.
Father, we have some announcements.
I have to say the final prayer. Okay. I haven't done that yet. I'm pretty sure.
We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Just a few announcements before we dismiss. On Saturday the 26th, the diocese is hosting the Evangelization Discipleship Summit here at St. Vincent. includes nationally known speakers Marcel Lejeune and Monsignor Shea from the University of Mary. And the Mass is to be celebrated by Bishop Rice. You can register in advance, and please see the bulletin for more information. Also, please note that the Clergy Institute is this week. It's one time of the year that the clergy, the priests, and deacons get together. So our Mass schedule's adjusted a little bit. There's no 5:15 Mass on Wednesday, and there's no 8 a.m. school Masses on Thursday or Friday, but there will be 6:30 Mass. And also, the hospital have adjusted their schedule. They'll have Mass at 8 o'clock on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. St. Gerard's Circle, a ministry for young, mothers of young children, will meet this Thursday at 7 o'clock in the lower meeting room. And finally, the Knights of Columbus will be in the church access to collect for the annual Tootsie Roll Drive for persons with developmental disabilities. I ask you to please give generously. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. You all have a good Sunday. I have to say this about you. You're very good-looking people. I don't know how you do it, but you do it. I guess you say, well, we just wake up, Father. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Small and mortal stature.